Hi, and welcome to Car Corner. My name's Richard Saxton. I'm the coordinator of the automotive programs here at the Community College of Philadelphia. In today's episode, you're going to see Dan Reed give you some exploding facts about airbags. If you have any other questions about our program, please check us out on the web. Thanks, and have a great day.
Hi, I'm Dan Reed with the Community College of Philadelphia's Automotive Technology Program. Welcome to Car Corner. Today, we're going to be looking at vehicle airbags, which are also known as supplemental restraint systems, or SRS systems. Now, first and foremost, I have to preface this with an important warning that airbags, while they have saved countless lives, they are extremely dangerous to work with while you're working on a car, and at no time, unless you are an expert and properly trained in airbag service, should you attempt to ever repair your own airbag system if there's a fault. People have been injured and killed by improperly servicing airbag systems. So while they have the potential to save lives, they do have the potential to do a lot of harm if you're not careful with them. Now, fortunately for us as everyday drivers, the airbag systems are actually pretty rock solid and you don't run into too many problems with them. And that's good. The only time we need them is when we have an accident. One of the most common misconceptions about airbags is that they could just randomly go off by possibly kicking a car or running over a rock or hitting a hard pothole. The fact is the system, which is actually monitored by the airbag diagnostic module, is going to be the device that actually has several sensors that are going to detect different types of impacts. And with about a wait time of about 15 milliseconds, it's going to come to the conclusion whether or not that impact was severe enough to set off the airbags or not. Now, the other thing is in regards to that impact that's going to set off the airbags, there's several things that are important factors. One is the angle of the impact and which airbags are going to go off. And the other one is the speed of the impact. And it's important to remember that not all crashes are the same. And a lot of times when you see those slow motion crash footage from the Insurance Safety Institute or car testing or something like that, where they show that slow, low speed collision and they show the crash test dummy bouncing around in the driver's seat, that not every crash is set up to be like that. And a car today could easily have up to 10, maybe even 12 airbags in the vehicle. They're not all going to deploy at the same time. If they did, first of all, it would be extremely expensive to repair the vehicle if they just all went off. So the computer actually makes that determination as to which bag should inflate. The car is able to use the crash impact sensors, which we'll talk about here in a second, to determine the angle and the speed of the collision, and then at that point, which bag should be deployed. Now, everybody's familiar with the driver's side airbag. Now, this is the airbag that looks at you and the steering wheel, and this has actually gone through several changes over the years. This is called the airbag module, and this actually bolts inside the wheel, and it's a separate component from the wheel itself. This unit actually contains the electrical connection and all of the important warnings on it about safe handling using the airbag. The fact is the car can actually drive just fine without this being in the vehicle, but obviously it's mandated to be there for safety. The driver's side airbag is designed to deploy generally when there's an impact over 14 miles an hour, and it has to be a solid enough collision to actually really jar the whole vehicle. Just because you actually hit something like, I don't know, maybe a pothole or a fence or a fence post or something like that, or a street sign at 14 miles an hour, that might not actually cause enough impact to the vehicle to actually cause this bag to deploy if you're traveling above that speed, 14 miles an hour. So we have the driver's side airbag. The second airbag that we have in most vehicles is the passenger side airbag. And you may notice that this one says SRS. And that stands for the word supplemental restraint system. What that means is that the system works whether or not the driver demands it being used or not. It's a supplemental restraint to the existing seat belts in the car, which should always be worn. should never be assumed that the airbags take the place of a seatbelt. They're actually there to help the seatbelt do its job better. And as we'll see in a couple minutes here, the seatbelts themselves actually contain airbags now too. Now the passenger side bag, we started to see passenger side bags in the mid to late 90s, whereas the driver's side bags started to come out around 1993 or so. And up until then, they were an option on some vehicles. It wasn't until probably the mid-90s that we really started to see the federal government mandate them. And I think it was until actually the late 90s where we started to see them in things like pickup trucks and SUVs. Up until then, they had a different set of crash standards. But back to the passenger side bag. A couple things about the passenger side bag is that, again, when you're in the car traveling, you should be seated properly, you should be sitting upright, you should be wearing your seatbelt. All too often, I see people with their feet up on the dashboard, sometimes even with their leg hanging out the window while the car is going down the road. And the fact is, if, you know, first of all, they're not wearing a seatbelt. Second of all, when this bag deploys, it will literally force your kneecaps through your forehead. It has the explosive power to do that. It has the explosive power to push a human body back approximately about 10 feet. So you can imagine this bag inflates rapidly. The deployment speed is around 200 miles an hour, and the entire process for both bags deploying happens in about 40 milliseconds. And to put that in perspective, the human eye, when you blink rapidly, is about 100 milliseconds. So in about half the speed of a blink is the total time it takes from the crash impact. The computer does its diagnosis, figures out which bags to deploy, and then it actually deploys the bags and starts to slow the body down as it moves towards the front. So for years, these were really the two bags that we had in the cars. And it wasn't until later that we started to see bags possibly in the seat or in the door. Now we'll take a look at an airbag in the door later in today's show. But the side impact bags are built into the seats. And then we also sometimes have curtain side airbags, which come down from the ceiling. And again, depending on the severity of the crash and the angle of the crash, that's designed to help protect the side of your body from an impact. A car in a front-end collision has a large crumple zone in front of it. So we really only need two bags, one for the driver, one for the passenger. The people in the back seat, they actually have the whole nose of the cabin, and again, the whole nose of the car to act as energy, to absorb that energy to slow the car down. Side impact, we have a much lesser area, so we actually will put a bag in the seat or a bag in the door. The side curtain airbag is designed to drop from the ceiling, so that way when your head the inertia of your head slides sideways from the side impact, your head doesn't hit the glass. It also helps prevent that other vehicle from intruding into your passenger cabin. So sometimes side impacts nowadays, you know, people talk about how expensive it is to get a car fixed after an accident. You have to realize that the car is designed to basically give its life so you can keep yours. And that's an important factor to keep in mind. If you walk away from any car accident, just consider yourself lucky. You can always buy another car, but there's only one of you out there. All right, so let's take a look at some of the other components in the system here. This is a airbag crash sensor. A couple things about the airbag system. You notice that we see a lot of yellow wiring, and the connectors for the airbags are yellow. And generally, that's to let other service people know in the industry that anytime they see yellow connectors or yellow jacketing around the wires, that those are wires that you should not disconnect. You should not probe them with a test light. You should just not randomly check them when you're, I don't know, looking for a burned out headlight or something on the car. This unit here, this is a crash sensor. This would be bolted to a structural part of the vehicle, and it's designed with a contact on the inside here that slides on a spring. When the car is hit, this little plunger, the weight of the plunger attached to the spring actually causes it to pop out. When it pops out, it creates an electrical contact that then our airbag diagnostic module is going to investigate. It's going to investigate that impact. If the impact is hard enough for this to make contact, and there's an internal safety switch inside this the airbag diagnostic module. If both sensors agree that the impact is hard enough, then the airbag module will deploy the signal to deploy whichever airbag is needed to be deployed, so that way the passenger doesn't get hurt. So that's just a little bit there about the crash sensors. The crash sensors, generally, in the event of an accident, they're going to have to be replaced along with the airbag diagnostic module and, of course, the deflated airbag. The component that attaches the driver's side airbag to the steering wheel is this piece, and this is known as a clock spring. Now, what's interesting about this device is our airbag has to have a constant contact back to the diagnostic module. At no time can there be any break in the airbag circuit, even if the battery is connected and the car is off. If you unplug an airbag connection, the airbag diagnostic module will see that disconnect and cause the airbag light to come on, tell you that there's a fault. So this clock spring device, what this does is this allows our airbag to stay in contact with the rest of the vehicle, and obviously we have to turn our steering wheel left and right as we drive. Well, in some systems we used to use a set of sliding contacts, a set of sliding brushes, and what the clock spring has on the inside is a constant winding of connections that allow the airbag to stay in constant contact with the module. I happen to have one of these things with the cover popped off so you can see how it works. When you turn the wheel left and right, the spring actually unravels. And if you think about how many times you turn a car left, how many times you turn a car right, it's generally about 2.5 turns left, 2.5 turns back to center, 2.5 turns right. What's tricky about these clock springs is that when you replace one, you have to make sure that you have it pointed in the right direction for the steering wheel. Give an example, if you were to have one of these replaced, if the technician wasn't careful, this piece could be overbound, and when you turn the wheel excessively, you would actually get a lot of binding on your steering wheel, and if you turn the wheel hard enough, you would actually snap this clock spring, and then you would have to replace it again. So the clock spring tends to be a component that on a lot of vehicles at high mileage, it tends to be the failure point, because in the airbag system, it's really the only part that actually moves left and right a whole lot while the car is driving. So that's our clock spring setup there. The other thing about the airbag connections is that the connections themselves, this one right here going into the fuse block is one, they're designed to be taken apart without using any type of special tools. The reason why is because manufacturers didn't want anybody to jam a screwdriver into the connection, possibly damage it, possibly shorting out the airbag system and causing a fault. Another interesting thing is that the actual connections themselves on the airbag are actually plated with gold, real gold, just like you would find on jewelry. Now that's done so that way there's no excessive resistance, since gold doesn't corrode, between our electrical connections. If you remember, I said you can't have a break in the electrical connection because otherwise the system will see a fault. Now, don't go ahead and just start ripping your car apart looking for buried treasure. The fact is the amount of gold on these electrical connections is actually pretty small. And there's probably more gold in your household computer than there is actually in these connectors. So just take that for what it's worth. All right, so plug that back in. All right. So let's take a look at how the airbag itself actually works. So let me move some of the stuff out of the way here. Move this out of the way. All right, so the airbag itself, when you look at the airbag, it's almost like it's sort of like a parachute, if you will, except that it can't be repacked. So there's no rebuilding airbags. You can't reassemble an airbag after it deploys. There's a nylon bag, and the bag is folded carefully. And then there's seams along the outside of the bag. When the bag is deployed, it's designed to actually rip these seams apart, and the bag itself then comes out with a whole lot of force. The deployment occurs on the back side. There's a small electrical connection, and it takes just a couple volts to set these things off. Generally, we have a 12-volt battery in a car, and it, you know, has 600 amps of possible current and all that type of thing. But it takes just a fraction of a volt to set off an airbag, and that's why you have to be very careful when you're working with them. And when it comes to checking them, you have to follow the manufacturer's directions, and we would never directly probe anything into here to see if this bag was itself was okay. If we did, the bag itself would most likely deploy at that point. There's actually a small shorting bar on the inside there, which is designed to prevent the bag from having static discharge setting off once the bag itself is actually removed from the vehicle, so it's safe to handle. Now the bag, once it's deployed, this is a bag that we deployed for our steering suspension class. Nobody was injured. We didn't run a car into a wall to do this. We had this mounted in a fixture and deployed it electronically. The bag itself is made out of durable nylon material. And the bag inflates for just a couple milliseconds. It's a very short inflation life. As soon as the bag inflates, there's actually holes on the back side of the bag here that actually are designed to blow out and tear away. And what these are is these are exhaust holes. As soon as the bag is deployed, the propellant, the gas that's used to deploy the bag, is vented out through here. Now what's interesting is the chemistry of the bag, I have to look at my notes here, the chemistry inside the bag is a mixture of sodium azide and potassium nitrate. When those two components mix, what they actually do is they put out a hot blast of nitrogen gas, and there's usually some residual powder left over, which is something akin to baking soda. It can be a little bit on the caustic side, so you'll hear people talk about how they got burned possibly by the airbag. The bag itself, actually, that chemical reaction, because it happens so quickly, is extremely hot. The back side of the bag, which is away from the driver, this piece can actually reach 300 degrees briefly as it heats up from that reaction. The plastic casing, the pretty part that you see on the horn on the outside, is designed to rip away at seams. And these seams, obviously, once the bag is deployed, you can't glue this back together. And any damage to the covering of the bag is generally means that at that point you should get rid of the bag. It shouldn't be used anymore. If the car has been involved in an accident, the reason why that bag deflates so rapidly is so that way if you are driving the car, if the bag were to deploy, you could actually still steer the vehicle through the crash if you had to, if you had that ability, if the crash wasn't that severe. And that way it didn't obscure your vision of the road. Now, the cover itself, on the inside, we may have the horn contact pad. This is the, you know, when you push the horn, either the whole bag itself can move as the horn button, or this one has an actual horn contact pad on the inside. And we actually took this apart without deploying the bag, and you can see the rip seams, the tear seams here, where this bag is supposed to rip as it's deployed. So just remember a couple very important things. Again, you want to be wearing your seatbelt, and you want to make sure you're the proper distance away from the steering wheel. Some early airbags deployed with a lot of force, and unfortunately, senior citizens, elderly or frail people, children, infants, if they're in the front seat of the vehicle, the force of this bag may be so much it may actually, could actually kill them. So that's why we would say to put children in the back seat and all those types of important warnings that you see when you look at your owner's guide for the vehicle. So just keep that in mind about airbags. The airbag itself is not alone in the way of trying to protect you. The other component that we have is the seatbelt. And this is actually a seatbelt retractor. Now this would normally be located on the pillar just behind the driver's door. And this is a retracting reel type mechanism. There's a spool on the inside here. And then we have this piece. This is known as the pendulum. And the way this works is that when you release the tension here, if you go to pull the seat, belt out across your body. So we can get this guy to release here in a second. There we go. Pull this out. The seatbelt can retract back and forth very, very easily. So as you get in and out of the car, you take the belt on and off. But there is a speed limiter. If this goes too fast, it actually locks. So it's designed to, again, just a slow motion. I got to reach down to the front of the car, get something, pull it back, and then if there's a sudden impact, it locks. The other time that it locks is if this tilts. This is actually a tilt mechanism. That's why it's called the pendulum. And if the car were to tip forward from the inertia of an accident, this also automatically locks. So it locks both ways, both with speed and with the tilt of the car. Now, we had that for years in seatbelts, and they worked pretty good until somebody said, you know, there's just not enough airbags in a car. We need to actually put airbags in the seatbelts, too. So cars have airbags in the seatbelts, and this is one of those things that seems to be a little shocking to people. But this surface right here, in this piece, this electrical connection right here, this is an airbag inside the seatbelt. And what it does is when the belt is out and retracted, the belt should be comfortable. It shouldn't, you know, pull you back against the seat or anything like that. But in the event of a crash, if the airbag diagnostic module commands it, it will actually fire. There's an explosive charge in here that's a very small version of an airbag. What that's going to do is that's going to cause a spring in here to actually spool this back and take out about a foot worth of slack from the belt. Now, this is important because we want to make sure that you are back with the seat as far back from the impact as possible, and that's what that's designed to do. What I have is I have one of these cut apart, opened up, and the force of these is actually severe enough that it will actually fray and destroy the seat belts. Now, if you've had a car that's been involved in a severe enough accident, most manufacturers recommend that you replace the seat belts after the accident. This is the main reason why, because this explosive deployment, once it explodes, this belt actually becomes useless. You can't put this back into service. This cover, which I've taken off right here, this one has been deployed. This cover, this chamber right here, the explosive charge winds a spring on the inside that actually pulls the spool back as the belt is discharged. And again, you know, there's airbags and all sorts of things that we have in the car. Sometimes I've had a couple relatives involved in minor collisions, and the belts went off, and the airbags themselves did not. And the car received minor damage, but they were okay. And they described it as it sounded like somebody was setting off fireworks inside the car. And then they could smell something burning. They then got out of the car, and everything was okay. But what they smelled was the actual propellant from the deployment reel here, and the smell of the deployment reel as well. Okay, so the last component in our system really can't be left out. And that is the actual airbag wiring harness itself. Now, this one would go all the way through the dashboard of the car, go to various components and sensors and crash triggers and bags. But it's important, you know, oftentimes we've talked about doing wiring repair and repairing wiring and that type of thing on the show. And it's important to realize that a lot of shops actually will not repair airbag wiring. They would rather replace the entire harness. Again, going back briefly to the gold-plated connectors, there's a chance that the work that the technician would do might not be completely perfect. Now, if that happens to be for something like a power window or rear defroster, no one's going to get hurt. But if it is the airbag system we're talking about, most shops won't take the risk legally to repair an airbag system without actually replacing it with all new components. It's an important point to talk about. And sometimes this adds greatly to the repair cost of the vehicle, especially if this harness is actually part of a main body harness in a vehicle, and it would require a lot of work to actually replace the specific harness. All right. So now that we've looked at some of these basic components, let's take a look specifically at the seatbelt retractor and an airbag, and take a look at what happens when they are deployed. What I have set up here is a set of four shop stools. And what I have is I have the seatbelt strapped between these bottom two chairs. Now this is bolted together and this is bolted here with a clamp. What I'm going to do is electrically hook this up and deploy the seatbelt. Now what that should do is spin the retractor wheel and pull these two chairs together, making these chairs fall on the ground and hopefully making a loud bang. But it'll give you an idea of the force of the seatbelt and how important it is to wear your seatbelt in the event of a front-end collision to make sure that you don't slide forward. So I'm going to get this set up here and we'll get going in a second. All right, and I'll do a little countdown. Two safeties, and are we ready? 3, 2, 1. And that gives you an idea of the charge that goes off when the seatbelt pulls itself together. Now, if we take a look at this, this is warm right now, and let me unbolt this. It smells, you can't smell it at home obviously, but it smells like fireworks right now. And this seatbelt at this point is no longer usable. And it's interesting to note that once that retraction occurs, the belt should, there we go. This guy got twisted up pretty nicely here, which normally wouldn't happen in a crash. But what I was going to show you is that the belt would still actually be able to be retracted at this point so you could get out of the vehicle. Okay, so that was pretty neat stuff. Let's take a look at an airbag deployment. Now we're going to deploy our driver's side airbag. And again, what I've done at this point is I've wired this up so it is going to deploy once I apply voltage to it. And this is why you should never ever poke around underneath the dashboard with a test light or a ohm meter or anything like that when you're near an airbag circuit. You should always make sure that the battery is disconnected from the vehicle and that you are working safely. So let's blow this. All right, everybody ready? 3, 2, 1. And you can see some of our gas coming out there through the vent holes of the bag. Now, the bag itself split just like it was supposed to. And boy, that's smelly stuff. I think we better let this air out here for a minute. So now that we've looked at some of the components involved with the supplemental restraint or airbag system in the car, what we have in the shop is a vehicle that has an airbag light on. And this is a great opportunity for you to see what an airbag light on the car looks like. So I'm going to turn the ignition on. And the airbag light is going to be over in the corner here. And it kind of looks like a person strapped into a seatbelt with a big balloon in front of them. But that's our airbag light. And now normally, if everything was okay, that light would actually go off at this point. So the light should not be on while the car is turned on in the on position. The fact that it's on indicates that there's a fault somewhere in the airbag or supplemental restraint circuit. So what we're going to do is we're going to actually have to scan the car using a computer. Now, normally, if you go to a small shop or someplace that's going to scan for engine codes, you might use a handheld diagnostic scanner like this. But the fact is this scanner is only going to be able to communicate with the engine and transmission data and get something like a check engine light code. We really need something much more powerful. We actually need to talk to the airbag computer in the car. So what we're going to do is I'm going to hook up that computer. And this is actually a two-part component. It has a wireless adapter plug. And this guy plugs in right here to our diagnostic connector for the vehicle. Like that. And then it has a separate dedicated scan tool component. And this is really, it's really a high-power laptop, essentially. It's a laptop that is designed to communicate with cars. And this is a full-blown, full-feature scan tool. And what this is going to allow me to do is actually communicate with the vehicle's computer and figure out what that code is, specifically when I tell this computer to talk to that module, what the problem is with the vehicle. So once this boots up here, we can get started. So now that we have our scan tool booted up, we have it connected to the car, I'm going to pick scanner. All right, we'll go in here. And this is where it's going to start to communicate with the vehicle. Now, this might take a couple steps. It's going to ask me a whole bunch of questions of actually what type of options the car has, what year the car is, and it's because I need to be able to make sure that the software loads properly so it can communicate with the airbags. So I'm going to pick BMW, and then I'm going to say that we have the domestic version of the car, and this is a 2003. And yes, we have an automatic transmission. Asking me if we have air conditioning. Yes, we have an air conditioning. Cruise control, yes, it's a nicely loaded car. And come in here and we'll pick auto ID. Continue. And at this point it's communicating with the car. And in a second here it should come up telling us what modules it's found. And one of the modules that it should be able to communicate with is our airbags. Let's see here, do you want to load? Yes, that's the engine that I have in the car. And so right here I have my selection of all the different communication modules that I can communicate with this particular vehicle. Now, again, going back to the basic, you know, your simple $100 scan tool that you might get at an automotive retailer, that's going to be able to talk to the engine and the transmission. What we're interested in here, and again, because this is a high-dollar tool, we're going to go and look at the airbag system in the car. And let's see here. Hit continue. And we're going to come in here and we're going to ask it what the trouble codes are. And we see that we have two codes. We have a seat occupancy sensor, and we have a side airbag front left, which is actually this door right here. Now, what this is going to involve me doing is going in, and actually the first thing I'm going to do is a visual inspection. And when you do a visual inspection, it's important to remember a couple key things about airbag circuits. One is whenever we're working with an airbag circuit, you want to make sure that you do not disturb any of the airbag cabling while the battery is connected to the car. So I'm not going to disconnect anything. I'm just going to pull this door panel off and have a look at that airbag in that door. Now, it's important also to remember that some cars have that airbag module in the seat. And if you have that in your vehicle, if the airbag is actually on the seat, it's going to say airbag on the side of the seat when you open the door. It's important to remember that you never ever put seat covers on the vehicle, because in the event that that bag has to deploy, it has to be able to penetrate that seat cover. Now, the seat covers that are on the car from the factory are designed to actually split apart like we saw before with the steering wheel bag. But this one right here actually comes out through the door panel. So in order to get in there to take a look at that, I'm going to take this door panel off. So let's get started with that. Going to first turn the ignition off, and I went ahead already and I looked up the procedure on removing this door. Every door panel comes off differently, and you have to be careful because the door panels themselves are extremely expensive, and unfortunately they're actually pretty fragile. Also, for the driver's door, there's all kinds of equipment that is attached to the driver's door. We have the door handle to let the driver out of the vehicle. We have the window switches. This car in particular has memory seat switches as well. And we have to make sure that we're very careful as we remove those components. I'm going to start with some of my nylon trim tools, which I like to use to actually remove these components. And we'll just start a little bit of prying to separate them. One other important thing is, again, every manufacturer's diagnosis is different. What I've done is I've gone ahead at this point and I've disconnected the battery from the vehicle, since we're going to be exploring some of the airbag components in here. But let's get started by taking this door panel off. And again, these nylon pry tools are extremely handy for some of these components that are difficult to take apart. And I have now is small access cover to take off here. I'm just using a pick. Footwell light comes out. Go. Sometimes you just have to take your time and be careful when you remove the electrical connectors. The switch is about $400 from the dealer, so I'm glad nothing broke. Pull out our receiver here, and I think at that point I should be good to go to. There's one little screw tucked in here that you have to pull out. There we go. Got that screw. Not to lose that screw,
and pull out our receiver here. And I think at that point, I should be good to go to start to pry this door panel off. Now, again, can't stress this enough. Battery's been disconnected. You know, we are working with an airbag. And also, again, the manufacturer, this door panel just comes off this way. Every door panel is different. Some lift up and then out. Other ones, you just have to look. So don't just assume that they all come apart this way. Go and off comes our door panel. Slide this piece in, fold that out of the way, carefully pull the stuff out, and I want to make sure that you have all your cords out of the way, all the wiring for the car, and I'm actually going to leave this one hooked up, which I guess is hooked up to the tweeter. And there's our airbag in the door right there. It's where the door-mounted airbag is. It's got those three bolts that hold it in. So at this point, what I'm going to do is just start looking over the wiring, making sure I don't see anything obvious in the way of damage, and everything looks okay. Now this connector should come apart again. I have the battery disconnected, and it almost looks like this connector is not plugged in all the way. Just give it a little. Yep, it is not plugged in. Definitely not plugged in. That would definitely cause my code. Now, the one thing that, for the vehicle history is somebody was in this car before to replace a window regulator for the power window, and they may have left this unplugged when they were in here. So that's probably a pretty good, if I plug this in, it should snap nice and tight together. It definitely was unplugged there. So I'm gonna put this back together and see if that fixes our fault. I'll hook the battery back up and run that self-test diagnostic again, and hopefully we'll have our code cleared out. Carefully push my wiring back through everywhere it's supposed to go. Just trying to get this little footwell light back. There we go. Door pocket, slide that back in, and make sure I get the lock knob over the top. There. Pop our door handle back together here. There we go. Slide that back in. Clips line up. There take our power window switch, put that back together. Memory seat plug back in. And then finally our footwell light. All right. So, just about ready for the moment of truth here. We'll turn our ignition key back on and see if we have the light turned out. Yep, and our light's out, so looks like we're good to go. I'm Dan Reed. Thanks for watching Car Corner. Drive safely.
I'm rolling here. Watch your eye, Dan, here.
Are you rolling?
Cold. That was ice cold, man. Chuck, why don't you get me a sandwich? Okay.